So here we are, back again with yet again another Promised Neverland review. This is going to be on chapter 54 of the Promised Neverland this time around. And this was a pretty interesting chapter, and it gave us a little bit more information regarding this new individual who we have been introduced in the previous chapter of the Promised Neverland, chapter 53, where the rest of the group stumbled upon this one single individual who has hunkered down into his very own shelter. And if you have been paying close attention, especially to his dialogue, you can pretty much tell what is going on with this character, especially with the symbolism that we got on the cover page of this chapter with the teacup. On the cover page of chapter 54, we pretty much have it to where we have our nameless character who we have at the moment. We don't really have a concrete name for this character at the moment, but he's laying down in a pretty much a broken down teacup. Now, this could be a connection that the author is making between, you know, Alice in Wonderland, for example, with the broken teacup, and pretty much it's just, you know, symbolizing his state of mind, how it's gone from, you know, technically a clear mind to now a corrupted and broken one. And I mean, judging by how he freaks out on Emma in the last chapter as well as in this one, how he reacts to the whole group in general, you can definitely tell that there is something up with this guy. Even in one of the panels, he is naming off several characters such as John and Lucas, and at first we probably think, yeah, this guy is insane. He must, you know, be so far gone because, I mean, technically he has hunkered down into his own shelter in which he has completely isolated himself from society. Pretty much remaining in a confined place for long periods of time will end up having an effect on your mind, especially if you are alone, because as humans, we crave social interaction. And this pretty much has led me to believe that, you know, because of him isolating himself for so long within this shelter, away from society, away from human interaction, he has, in fact, actually brought upon some level of split personality, as from what we saw here in this chapter, as when he is talking to Lucas or John, the text actually changes, you know, pretty much showing a different case of the dialogue or the tone in which, you know, he is, you know, talking about when it comes to those two individuals. And judging from the connection that we can make from these two names to the last panel of this chapter, Lucas and John actually appear at the very last page of the chapter as well. So there is, in fact, the names of Lucas and John on the wall, but there is also various other names as well as Days, and I'm assuming that this is actually the dude's room. We don't have the name for the character, so I'm just saying the dude. But this has to be his room. It's most likely that this is actually the guy's room, as technically the door was already opened. And then two, if you can draw the connections between the names, you can quite assume that this was actually the guy's family. Not, you know, literal sense of the word family, but as far as a group like Emma, Ray's, and the rest of the kids go, I'm talking about that sort of group. There were other kids that were involved with that individual that we have now, you know, seen in these past few chapters of the Promised Neverland that has gone completely insane in front of Emma and Ray. That was his family. And he actually said to Emma in chapter 53 that pretty much he is the only survivor left, which leads us to assume that, yes, it is in fact that the guy's family is in fact dead and he is in fact the only survivor. And also, even when Emma was giving him a pep talk, when pretty much the dude was saying that, you know, comrades, hope, all that stuff does not matter, Emma saying that, you know, you're completely wrong in that factor, they do matter, they are important, that actually struck a chord within this guy, which in turn made him, you know, act out the way he did by the end of the chapter. And we actually saw several flashbacks with him, as well as with other kids within, you know, his own state of mind. So that also leads us to believe that, yes, this dude did in fact have a family just like Emma and Ray, and because of the effects of him isolating himself after their deaths, this has definitely caused him to go insane. But yeah, I'm pretty sure that is exactly what had happened. I mean, the dude pretty much had a family like Emma and Ray and, you know, tried to escape the orphanage as well. Ultimately, though, by trying to escape, pretty much he was the only survivor amongst his family. And in order to survive and fend for himself, he hunkered down into a shelter and pretty much, you know, this has caused him to pretty much go insane just due to the confines of his shelter and, you know, just not, you know, going out to the outside world, interacting with anything in sight because of the fact that he lost so many important people to him. And just to try to see if he can actually, you know, remember a part of them or at least keep some form of sanity to him, what he has left of it, is to actually, you know, take those people who were important to him and pretty much bring upon a personality of them within his mind. So that is probably what is going on here. Unless the dude actually killed off some of his own family members or maybe even left them for dead, and with that, it has led him with a life filled with guilt because of that. So there is that. But hey, we don't know the full extent of this guy's past, so I mean, there's still not a whole lot to go off of, but we'll most likely find out, you know, what exactly happened to this guy's family, you know, in the next few chapters of The Promised Neverland, because it's just to be expected. And I'm pretty sure this is most likely what is going on with this guy's state of mind and what exactly has happened to him, just judging by the kind of connections that you can make up from this chapter. I mean, I don't really think it's that too hard to figure out what exactly, you know, state of mind this guy is in. And I mean, the author kind of implied as to what is going on with him in general. So there is that. Now, as far as the final panel in this chapter goes with the word poachers, I have no idea what this could mean. This could possibly mean that, you know, it's just another word for the demons, because technically poachers are killers. So, I mean, hey, we don't know. It could be a reference to the demons, but it could be a reference to something else entirely, because it could end up biting them in the ass in the future. But who knows? Who knows what it is? But yeah, this was pretty much just a chapter pretty much showing us the state of mind of this character and an important role that he will most likely play in the future of the series later on, you know, for our, you know, main characters as we learn more information about him. So, and also basically, you know, the other kids that were involved within his group. So yeah, let me know your thoughts in the comments down below. What you guys thought about this chapter of The Promised Neverland? What did you think about my review? Just let me know your overall thoughts. Be sure to give this video a like if you enjoyed. I'll see you guys in the next one.